Okay, so next up is Jaydeep and Rebel. In the past, we've talked about Faasos. It's been a journey over, I think, the last 2 years getting to the new name, the new identity.
Yep.
But I think the business model has emerged very clearly, and now it's scaling up. So I think today we're going to talk about how the kitchen has died.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Drew has raised the bar so much in terms of interest or engagement generated within this crowd that I feel under tremendous pressure. Do we need like a couple of minutes of break? Yeah? Or at least standing up and then sitting down again? Can we do that? Cool, it's okay. thank you very much. So the one thing Drew said that, the other JB, Jeff Bezos, he said what's not going to change in 10 years. I think if we ask what's not going to change in 100 years, I think the answer would be food won't be downloaded. I mean, I think that's a reasonable guess. And that is the guess on which we are building this business. Because the day food is downloaded, we are out of business. But before food, something else is dying, which is the kitchen at your home. Here's the proof, $150 billion delivery market worldwide, 25% CAGR, 150% growth in India itself. More and more people getting food delivered than going out and eating. It's a secular trend, an irreversible phenomenon that's happening. It has happened starting with books, then travel, then hospitality, then car, and commute. Now food is the last frontier of internet, if we think like that. Now here's a proof of that. World's largest retail company, internet. Largest or most valuable internet entertainment company, Netflix, internet company. Most valuable hospitality, internet company. Most valuable commute, internet. Most valuable travel, internet. Most valuable restaurant company, still offline. McDonald's, $130 billion. And there are, 1,000 others behind them. So our goal in life is to change that. Now, that might sound like a little audacious, but we think we are at least 20 times more advanced than anyone in the world to actually make that happen. And I'm going to show you why I'm making that claim. So it's a bad chart. I've been a consultant once, and once you're a consultant, your sort of genetic makeup changes irreversibly. So I can only think in 2x2. I'm sorry about that. So how does, food is a very unique sort of customer journey. So if you think about, in most other consumer goods, there are two segments, largely, value and luxury, right? Either you fly business or coach, either you wear an Armani suit or a t-shirt like this, either anything, either you own a Mercedes or a Maruti, right? It happens in every sector. Food is the only consumer category where you move from value, like your 10 rupee chai on the street, to 5-star within a week. So in food, segments are not people. Segments are people's food missions. And this is the only category that this happens. I mean, the only exception is, I think, I was saying Sid, who moves from luxury to Uber luxury. I don't think he's out of that. But most of us, most of the rest of us, go from a weekday lunch, which is a value meal, to evening snacks in office, to biryani Chinese food for a large group of friends at home, protein juices, subscription at gym, keto, craving for a special exotic cuisine, all of this within a week's time, within a month's time. Now, the other interesting thing is that for each of these missions, we have an expert in mind. Like if you go for a burger, we go to McDonald's. I mean, crappy burger, but still burger. We go to Domino's for pizza. We go to Starbucks for coffee. We go to, a new age health startup for keto diet, and so on and so forth. So when you put these two things together, this sort of thing has happened in FMCG, right? Where your P&G touching every point of your journey through different products. But in food, it hasn't happened. because it is impossible to have one common infrastructure of marketing, distribution, production to create many brands that would satisfy different missions, which is where we come in. We built an FMCG-like structure. Probably we're the only ones in the world at scale who now could build a business targeting each of the food mission of a customer's journey from a single infrastructural base. So if you think about Pizza Hut, Taco Bell, KFC, all different outlets, different management, different supply chain, all owned by Yum Brands, one company. For us, one kitchen, multiple brands. Now, that sounds like an obvious concept that if you have a kitchen like a five-star hotel, you can make a pizza, biryani, nasi goreng, you know, quesadilla, lasagna, and all of that. You can actually, you know, create brands. Sounds quite obvious. But that's the tip of the iceberg. And I'll come back to this slide when all of you are going to ask me, if at all, you know, very difficult questions. Like, why can't Swiggy do this? You know, these are questions that I've seen in the past. And I'll come back to this slide to prove my point that why Swiggy can't do it. But basically, below the tip of the iceberg of one kitchen, multiple restaurants, there are four competencies that are needed to be built to drive that sort of a game plan. So one is tech. Now, when we say food tech, everybody thinks, okay, ordering from an app and the food getting at my home. That is a food tech in our mind. But the actual food tech is how to run food making, which includes automation, robotics, actual managing your kitchen, your inventory. That's real food tech. And we have a technology stack which is absolutely world-class, the most unique in the world. In fact, our tech team keeps saying that this should be the AWS for cloud kitchens, but that's maybe another time. We have a culinary innovation center led by 10 chefs who can create or pick up a dish, can deconstruct into bill of materials, how to dispense it, how to make it, and scale it. Last year, we scaled 280 different products from Thai curry to biryani across India. Third is a pan-India supply chain, which is a common thread that runs across our kitchens, which makes us, which enables us to create a product, supply it from Delhi to Chennai seamlessly. And then last and not the least are 190 cloud kitchens. It's going to be 500 by the end of December, by the end of 2020. And every time I speak about this slide, Prashant tells me, you have to talk about the last one more, because that's your real moat. And usually in the VC meetings, people don't generally understand DNA culture. I mean, everybody wants to see cohort, LTV, CAC, so on and so forth. So it's usually useless talking about DNA and culture in VC meetings. But Lightbox is different, and you people are different. So I'll take 1 minute to talk about the DNA building in our company. So some examples. So in the kitchen staff, we have 5% attrition year on year, which compared to industry average is about 120%. The CDO level, which is each kitchen is managed by a guy who is called a chief delight officer. He's the real CEO of the business. I am not. And that guy owns the P&L, customer delight, everything. It's his business. He drives it. In the last year, out of the 190 CDOs, we lost one CDO. That's the level of attachment. That's the level of vision alignment we have in our company. In the XCOM, which is senior management, me and seven other people, all of these guys have been in this company for 6 years or more, almost from the beginning, which is, again, you know, unheard of in the startup sort of ecosystem. And I think there is only one reason, maybe two, why this is happening in our company. So one is ownership, entrepreneurship at the core of it. Once a task is given to someone, open this city, open this market, open this kitchen, there is no micromanagement. Success is his, failure is his. So this, you know, building entrepreneur after entrepreneur after entrepreneur has really worked for us. And secondly, there is no boredom at Rebel, because today you're working on some food, tomorrow there is some other food. In fact, every Wednesday there is a food testing session. Now, if you leave Rebel, you are not part of the food testing session. So I guess that's a big reason why people tend to stick about. So once we have this platform and the kitchens and so on, this is how we run our brands. Now imagine you as an entrepreneur trying to start a new restaurant. What are your steps? You know, shell out $200,000, build a big kitchen, build a big restaurant, put chairs, nice lightings, et cetera, et cetera. You start on day one, actually you have the highest volume ever, you know, and from day two, it's always downhill. And 65% restaurants die within year one. That's the statistics. For us, we don't do any of that. So once we conceptualize a brand, we put it in 2 to 5 kitchens, put it on aggregators, and aggressively seek feedback. And once the rating goes more than 4.2 out of 5, then only we scale. Otherwise, we don't. So which means, like a tech product, we don't spend money before there is a product market fit. And I don't have this slide, which is another favorite slide of Prashant's, comparing our Zomato ratings versus Domino's, McDonald's, and a few other scaled-up companies. We are 2 to 3 times better rated, 200 times better rated than any of these guys, which means this is working at scale. So what it means, our operating model, our business model, and our ability to launch brands without investment, without spending money, and so on and so forth. What it means is today, on these metrics, these are familiar metrics, right? Family, friends, single, serve, regular, luxury. Today we have over 10 brands that we started in the last 24 months. Some are famous, some are not so famous because they are just getting started. But what it really means, is that Behrouz today, it's a biryani brand, is there in 180 locations. That means we have 180 restaurants of Behrouz today. 175 Faasos restaurants. 145 Sweet Truth restaurants. 180 Lunchbox restaurants. All on the cloud, right? But when a customer opens an app, he sees these restaurants as separate entities. It's a little bit, you have to think about it to get it. Like Amazon is not Amazon. When you say how many locations Amazon is present, you don't count their warehouses. Similarly, if someone asks me how many restaurants we have, any guesses how many restaurants we have based on what I said so far? Yeah, we have 1250 because, I'll tell you why. We have 190 kitchens, which are warehouses, which are hosting 1250 restaurants today in India. Which, by the way, bigger than Domino's number of restaurants. This chart last week was Domino's, and then we were second. But then yesterday, or day before yesterday, we launched a brand called Lunch Good Bowl in 150 locations on single day, which means we added 150 restaurants to our network. Now, when you think about India, 100,000 restaurants in total compared to 7 million in China, in 5 years' time, in India, we'll have 50,000 restaurants. 50,000 compared to maybe, you know, 200,000 total restaurants in India. We would be 20 times bigger than any other restaurant company in India. It's somewhat like the story that you're seeing unfolding in Oyo. You know, people say, okay, but Swiggy, can't they do it? But think about it. Oyo is 2 times more valuable than MakeMyTrip. The same game is going to be played here, as far as I am concerned. We'll see what happens. I don't have the crystal ball. But there would be a time when we'd be controlling a humongous share of the restaurant pie in India because of our model. This is the proof of the pudding. So someone said in Lightbox LP meetings, there are not many revenue charts. So I thought I'll put one. This is our kitchen growth. So our kitchen count grew by 30% in the last 24 months, and this is how our revenue grew. And math, for the mathematically inclined, you can see the slope is also increasing, which is when you start calling it exponential, right? So this month we are doing about 35 crore of revenue. We are, you know, $60 million run rate. Last year, December, we did 15 crore revenue, so 120% almost growth year on year. And very minimal capex spend. So it's the most capital efficient way of building a restaurant business, and a formula that probably nobody else in the world has discovered so far. One example, Behrouz Biryani is our biryani brand, launched 24 months back. India's second largest biryani brand, 20 million ARR revenue in 24 months. Zero additional capex, no extra building, no extra outlet, no extra equipment, no additional OPEX. This month is going to do about 14 crores in revenue. All of that put together, we've grown 5x in last 8 quarters, 60 million ARR. And while all of this is happening, this is our kitchen EBITDA, also increasing. So this is not like, you know, 20 million per month burn sort of a story. Our burn hasn't gone up by a single penny in the last 24 months. All this has been unit economics positive. That's what it tells you. When a 5x growth comes, exponential, looking more like exponential without increased burn, there's only one underlying theme or insight from that, that this is a business which is not buying its way out. It's a business where unit economics is working. It's a model that is working. What is in the works for us? So now that we have 10 brands, so these are all the brands where experimentation is going right now. But we also realized that what we have built is like an operating system where you have kitchen, supply chain, technology, culinary skills, and the DNA. On top of that, if you open up this operating system and let other entrepreneurs build their brands on top of it, it would be tremendously powerful. Because for us to get to all of these, maybe we'll take, you know, 5, 6, 7 years. But we can open this up and can have an entrepreneur who has a beautiful product with a great product market fit, selling in Bandra. We can scale that guy tomorrow within 2 months to Pan India. We can bring Impossible Burger from US and run it on our platform tomorrow. We can bring Chipotle, we can bring Shake Shack. We can do anything. We have the operating system. And on top of that, we can plug and play small brands scaling up, big brands coming in, entrepreneurs being built on it. And that is why this, to me, is, that is why I was telling Sid, I think, that I wish I was 25 years old, because this will take time, and I think we are on the right course. That's it. Yeah.